وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبا القاسم محمد. على آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري، احلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ما بعد. Respected scholars, elders, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Insha'Allah, in light of the previous week's topic, when we talked about the intelligence of our Imam that we celebrated last week, and the banner, inshallah, will be behind us for the remainder of the week, which is Imam Rida alayhi afdal as-salati wa salam. Now, people have been questioning as to where to find the references for everything that was mentioned last week, and I've answered them, but they've also asked if I could repeat an analogy of the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because last week what we talked about was, in detail, knowledge and how to have wisdom in who to talk to, how to talk to them. And inshallah, the question was, how can we justify, or how can we look at the bigger picture, in which is Allah's justice? Because many people say that, what do we have to know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's justice? How does Allah's justice apply to us, especially in the 21st century? Is it something that we must learn and understand? Or is it something that it's taught in the houses, and only knowledgeable people have to have a detailed idea about this particular aspect? Now, the response is very simple, even though it's very detailed, but it's very simple. To analyze Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's justice is something to look at from the infallible point of view, to actually understand Allah's justice. But if we glimpse on Allah's justice, we can understand more so what happens to us on a daily perspective. As in, we can begin to realize, we begin to realize that if we make dua, if the dua is not answered, Allah's justice plays a part. If we end up with a particular spouse, if we don't end up with a particular spouse, if we have children, if we don't have children, if we go to a particular place, if we don't go towards a particular place, if Allah has written, how much has He written for us? What does the wealth aspect have to do? The relationships, our lifespan, everything that encompasses us, what we are given, what's been taken away, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah, everything falls under the opening circle or opening headline, which is Allah's justice, and can be justified. When we look at two different schools of thought, one being the school of thought of Ahlul-Bait, and all other schools of thought within the Islamic scope, we find that the pillars, that many people have three pillars, however, we have five pillars. As in, we know that the other schools of thought, they believe in, yes, that there is Allah, there is something called Tawheed. There is something called Ma'ad in that aspect, and there's something called Nubuwah. That's the three aspects that everyone doesn't differentiate. However, the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt have two extra particular principles, one of which being Imamah. And we have that different from any other school of thought. And also we have something and a concept called adala. Meaning what? Meaning the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So on that level by itself, knowing that these two things that we have extra within our pillars means that we have to understand the concept of imamah. We have to look into what the concept of imamah instills. How does it apply to our lives? And likewise, as much as we put emphasis on imamah, and how imamah's put at a high rank, it's very important to look at the concept of adala, because it will clarify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's grand names and how we can justify it to our lives. I'll give you an example. Musa alayhi salam seeked to analyze how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's justice works. Because many people come towards Musa at the time, Bani Israel, many problems arise. People come towards Musa alayhi afdhal salatu wassalam and they tell him, Musa, why is this happening? Why is that happening? Can you tell us the justice behind it? So Musa alayhi salam goes towards Allah, Kalimullah. He goes and talks towards Allah and he says, can you show me your justice? There's many aspects that I don't understand the in-depth of it. Why has this person gained this? What reason has this person gained that? Why is there differences? I would like to see the inner justice for its essence. Can you show me, O Allah? Because nowadays we have the same question within our thoughts. How can we understand Allah's justice? How can we justify that which we get, that which we don't get, where Allah has placed us? Where's the justice in any particular action that we do or we are given to make a choice? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to show Musa what he's trying to show us. And that is, that when Musa sees what he sees, we'll begin to analyze how much do we really see of Allah's justice. It's a very famous story if we contemplate over it. And I'm re-mentioning this story so we may understand together how Allah's justice works and how we can never reach an understanding of the essence of Allah's justice until we gain to the ranks of the ma'sumeen, in which we can see with the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that needs a detailed discussion that we can look into how to reach that rank. Musa alayhi salam, Jibreel comes down, he says to Musa, he says, I will show you Allah's justice. He says, show me. So he says, stay at this particular well. Don't do anything. I just want you to watch what happens. When you see this, you will see Allah's justice in its essence. He says, okay, so he waits. At that, well, he waits. As he's waiting, there's a night that comes past. Or as we know in the hadith, it says al-Faris, which is a knight in armor, comes on his horse. In his youth, he comes with the well, drinks water, and from him slips a pouch of money. And then he goes on. Then a young man comes, drinking water. He's thinking, you know what, it's my lucky day. I found a pouch of money, takes the money, goes. After that, there's an old man that comes, and he's about to drink from the water. At the same time, the knight remembers that, you know what, I don't have the money anymore. The only place I've gone is the well. So he goes back towards the well. He sees an old man. He tells the old man, he says, listen, I've lost my money pouch, and I know that I've only lost it in this particular area. Therefore, you're the only person that might have my money pouch. Would you give me the money pouch? Or I'll prosecute you. So the old man's thinking, you know what? I have no idea where this money pouch is, where it came from. I've never seen it. And he's telling this to this knight. And the man doesn't believe him. Argument takes place until what? The knight takes a sword and he beheads the old man. Then the wahi comes towards Musa. Says, did you see Allah's justice? That's the essence of Allah's justice. He says, hold on, I haven't seen justice. He says, no, this is justice. You wanted to see Allah's justice. Then you've seen it. He says, where's the justice? Can you explain further? He says, you wanted to see it. Now I'll explain it for you. He says, what is the explanation behind it? He says, number one, he says, that Faris owed that young boy, and he says in the hadith, a particular amount of money. He says the exact amount of money that he owed towards that boy's father, the young boy that took the money, was in that pouch. And he didn't think about giving that money back. So Allah's taking it from him and giving it back to its rightful owner in one way. He says, how about the old man that got beheaded? I can understand. What about the old man that got beheaded? He says, that old man killed that Faris's father. And this is in return, he is getting his, what we can look at as nowadays, for lack of better words, revenge. So he says, look at the justice. Everything is in proportion. You got the explanation. When people see it at the first glance, they think to themselves, you know what, there's no justice. People look at the world and say, you know what, why is there poor people? Why is there rich people? Why is Allah differentiated in the classes, differentiated in the ranks? Why are people dying of hunger? Why are other people swimming in the money? Swimming in sustenance? People come and question Allah's justice in this aspect. However, when we look at it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided enough on this earth to sustain everyone. It's the problem with, and there's a hadith that relates to Ali ibn Abi Talib, says it's the problem with people's greed. They have enough, but they want more. Stuff that they don't even use, they don't need, but they need to accumulate to suffice their inner desires. And the problem with greed is that the more you have, the less other people have. And that's what we can look at, not to justify this particular action, but however, trying to understand the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means that we need to understand how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the system in place, the reward system, how Allah gives punishment, prosecutes, and how Allah has mercy on other things, how your actions may elevate you, how your action may degrade you, how it all works. And it all starts within ourselves. How we instill in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we know, the better we are. Many people come and say, you know what? That, and give me an example. People come and they say, well, Allah has given me many calamities. Number one, let's justify it. If you've got a calamity, people might find sickness a calamity, but they don't look at the inner mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Chapter 2 of the Quran, verse 285, it says, Allah will not burden a soul more than it can handle. So number one, we know that Allah will not give you a test unless He knows that you will pass it. Unless you know that that burden will not be the end of you, that you will contain this. You are up for this particular burden and you will surpass it. As in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once a man came to him and says, oh Rasulullah, look at this. And this is something we need to look at, especially as the followers of Ahlul-Bait. Comes towards the Prophet of Islam and says, oh Prophet of Islam, I dedicate myself to you and I, in front of you, bear witness that I have love towards you. I love you, O Rasulullah. Look at the response of Rasulullah. He says, then prepare yourself for poverty. Ista'adla lil-faqr. He says, prepare yourself for poverty. He says, what else do you believe in? What else do you love, O man? He says, I also love Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, look at what he says. He says, for me, if you love me, prepare for poverty. Prepare to give from your wealth. Prepare to give towards those that are less, that are more needy. Prepare for poverty. As we know, the person that with her wealth, Islam grew was Khadija, and she didn't even have a shroud, a kafan for her. That's the amount or what came towards poverty in those lands. So the Prophet tells him, he says, if you love me, prepare yourself. He says, I love Ali ibn Abi Talib. What does he say? He says, استعد للبلاء. Prepare for calamities. And as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? About calamities. He says, the more Allah loves a particular servant, He gives them more and more calamities. So the more you look at yourself and think to yourself, well, Allah has given me this particular, if we want to call it calamity. Other people look at it as a sense of mercy. People look at sickness saying this is a sickness and it's something that Allah has given me as a burden. Other people look at sickness saying what? From our hadith, he says they look at it as mercy. Why? He says because every time I have a sickness or an illness, the hadiths say that Allah is removing slowly, slowly from my sins, cleansing me of my sins. And if I don't have any sins, people come and say, well, I don't have any sins. I prayed, I fasted. Our hadith say, if you don't have any sins, and that's very minimal unless you're a ma'soom, if you don't have any sins, Allah, from the sickness and the illness, elevates you. So when we look at that in instance, if we look at the justice, and we think we can devour what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for us, we'll always fail because we don't see the bigger picture. When we read in Ramadan time and time again, in Dua al-Iftitah, telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I complain to you whenever I make towards you dua and supplication. And he says, لَعَلَّ الَّذِي أَبْطَأَ عَنِّي هُوَ خَيْرٌ لِي لِعَلْمِكَ بِعَاقِبَةٌ. It's as if to say what? That I complain towards you whenever I make dua and you do not give me that which I want. However, I have knowledge and I know for a fact that whatever you have refrained from me may be better from me for your knowledge of what comes from circumstances, what comes in the end note where I will attain a position. You have knowledge over it. Now, how can we bury it down? Inshallah, it's taken much of the time and I have to complete this lecture for tonight. And inshallah, we can continue next week with the topic of, inshallah, the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and gaining an understanding of it. However, I want to end by mentioning something. Inshallah, we'll look at Ali ibn Abi Talib in depth to look at the justice of Allah on earth, to look at the representative, to show us what knowledge of justice will instill into a person. If you have knowledge of Allah and have knowledge that Allah is watching, Ali ibn Abi Talib has a beautiful statement. When they ask him, how is it that you've attained this greatness? He says, look, he says two things. Justice, in the words of Ali ibn Abi Talib. I want to mention two things that he says that will, if we apply only these two things to our lives, look how much we will grow in the eyes of Allah. Two things of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, number one, I have an understanding that people are of two types, and there is a third, but mostly of these two. Either they worship Allah in fear of His heaven, or in greed of His heaven, or in fear of His hellfire. So for example, I want the bounties of heaven. I want, for example, people come say, I want the rivers in paradise. I want these houses that Allah promises. I want the Hur al-Ain, for example. So he prays, he fasts, what? Wanting that particular position. Other people say, you know what? I've read much in the Quran about the adab, that the people go in hellfire, how their skins will burn and be replaced, and burn and be replaced. He says, I fear that. Therefore what? I'm going to pray towards Allah so He may take me away from this particular punishment. Ali ibn Talib says, but I found that Allah is worthy to be worshipped. Therefore I have worshipped Him. A third level. Now let's look at the second thing. If we put this into our lives, that we know the rank of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how to view Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how to know Allah's names and His bounties, and His reflections, through His reflections on earth, which are the Ahlul Bayt, to begin to understand Allah in a greater light, once we understand these people. Now the second thing I want to look at, Ali ibn Abi Talib says a beautiful statement about how every single action he does, he says, whatever action I do, I look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before, during, and after. Before I commit this action, or before I go towards this action, I look, is Allah happy with this action that I'm about to do or go towards? If I find yes, that Allah is happy, I go towards it. During the action, something might have changed. Knowledge might have changed. Perseverance might have changed. Direction might have changed. I look at Allah during the action. Is Allah happy with what I'm doing? And after. After I've done what I've done, is Allah happy with me then? Have I, when I've done this particular act, have I increased in Allah's point of view? Or have I increased in riya, for example? Have I increased in pride, in showing off towards the people? I look at Allah after as well. People might look at, no, this is just an act, it doesn't have a before or doesn't have an after. However, if you look at the depth of it, that there's three different dimensions, if not more. That's just what Ali ibn Abi Talib mentions towards us. He says, I look at Allah before, during, and after. And if He's happy throughout, then I am sufficed. Let's try to apply that to our lives. Let's try to take that concept and apply it to our lives. Do we look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before any actions? Because by God, if we do, we would not commit any atrocities. We would not commit any sin. We'd be infallible. That's why Allah puts a significance on remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remembering death, remembering the resurrection, remembering the day of judgment. Mentioned many times in the Quran, remind them of the days of Allah. And Imam Mahdi ajalla ta'ala farajah al-sharif, he watches us. In a hadith we have every Friday, our actions are portrayed in front of him. Look at what we've done that's good, portrayed. What have we done that's bad, portrayed. He sees who we are. And that's why he's waiting. 313 people can't come and arise, that they may be of the companions of our Imam that's been awaited. The whole world awaits him. We cocoon him just to the Shi'a school of thought. The whole world is awaiting the return of the Imam. People that are not from the faith of Ahlul Bayt will come towards him. Christians will come towards this message, will become Shia on his hand, knowing the position of him and his justice, putting hand in hand with the Imam of our time. That's why we have to better ourselves. And inshallah, we can elaborate more so next week by looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger on earth. the Prophet of Islam, and how we can learn from his justice and how he had justice in his actions. Because it's one aspect knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his justice, and it's another applying justice to our lives. We can look at it theoretically, but the importance is the practical application. How, inshallah, next week we can look at how we can take from the lives of the Imams, take from the life of the Prophet of Islam, and learn step by step everything that they've applied to their life with the justice and the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to take exactly what they've done, and we want to do it in our lives, and we want to see how much our lives change from that aspect, inshallah. And I end on that note, inshallah, and I give way to our dear Sheikh to give us wise words, inshallah, and enlighten us with his wisdom. But I end tonight and pray to Allah on that note, that he may increase us in knowledge and understanding of Allah's mercy and Allah's justice, so that we can, inshallah, live up to the expectation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be elevated in his eyes. Surah al-Mubarakat al-Fatiha. But before, three of your loudest salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.